I'm going to take off my
shirt,
my pullover because it's too hot.
Ah. Yeah, it gets warm here. Sorry.
Too hot. Doesn't mean it's really so hot.
Are you here primarily because you have your first premiere of a movie in
first Los time Angeles? In my life, my first movie.
But it's 19. The picture is premiering for the first time in the United States at the Cinematheque. Yes.
Which one you talk
Lion
about?
Oh
yes, absolutely. If you talk about Rosaline and the Lions,
yes.
First time. I think nobody has ever seen this picture in America.
So is that exciting? Does it feel like it's fresh again, or?
I would like to be fresh again. At least it's fresh for the audience, because it's one of those films that I always thought could play in America and never did, and I don't know why.
Well, your stuff was so hot. I mean, you're
That's why I don't get that.
So what was that experience like? I mean, it's changed. Things have changed in the way films are distributed and the art films are distributed so much.
Probably.
And both the earliest, the Diva and the Betty Blue were just kind of these massive, ubiquitous films. Were you conscious of, I mean, was that a unique experience? Well, I'm sure it was a unique experience, but was it what was that like back, you know, when those things happened?
It was big. It was absolutely unpredictable. I remember the first experience of Diva in America, New York. People starting to talk nicely to me, and I never understood why. They stare at me like if I was somebody special, and I was especially thinking that I was nobody, so I felt that was very strange. And all of that started after such a failure in France, because the film, when it primarily was released, was such a flop. It was kept in the cinema for 1 year. It is something that couldn't happen today.
Right.
Because today, you know, a film goes out and 2 hours later, they know it's over.
Yeah.
So this movie was not doing well at all. The critics were, French critics were terrible. So I thought I had made two films for the price of one, my first and my last. And slowly it built up after 1 year and made a huge success in France. But meanwhile, I had to struggle with my producers in order we can compete in the Toronto Film Festival.
And they didn't want to go.
They didn't want to go. They were afraid of exposing the picture could damage the picture. And I said to Serge Silberman, who was the producer, I said, what damage can we do with this picture? We are already dead. And there was a guy, I really would like to thank the memory of this guy because he's dead now, called David Overby. He was the guy who was doing the programming Toronto. And he wanted badly the film, so we had to blackmail Serge Silberman because David had made an interview of Serge Silberman, who was the former and the latest producer of the Spanish Mexican director Buñuel, and he used to say that one thing he loved with Luis Buñuel was he was a man of parole. And he said, "Will you be like him? Because you promised me you send me Diva 6 months ago." And finally he said yes. And I remember Toronto with the feeling of having made a film that was a disaster. And the day I arrived, I mean, totally jet lagged. I mean, I was literally out of the plane, then in the cinema.
Right.
And a standing ovation. So I was like, something goes wrong, you know? You know? I am in another dimension. And it keep doing like that for the rest of my life. Mm-hmm. I'm never totally in tune with what happened. I'm always ahead or behind.
Did you get caught up in the ego of that moment? I mean, it sounds
like... Of course, yes.
I mean, you came from it, you would have been an AD and made a couple few short films.
Only one
short film. Yeah. So this was... And then this was seemed like a failure, you thought.
Yeah.
So...
It was more a failure than a success. And I always had to fight to get in tune with this idea of a success. I remember meeting in New York, I think it was one of the major actors in America, playing with, I can't remember, well, but he was talking, and then somebody introduced me to, he's the guy who did Diva. Oh, nice meeting you. Mm-hmm. It's funny.
Yeah, it wasn't playing with his BlackBerry back then.
No,
iPhone.
there was no BlackBerry, no internet. If you look at Diva, nothing. The technology that is used in Diva is low technology, but it talks about technology and reproduction, duplication. Mm-hmm. It only talks about that. It's very funny.
Mm-hmm. It definitely was ahead of its time, as was Betty Blue. I mean, it was really. Both films, I think, caught people on the wave of something new happening that they weren't really expecting to see at the cinema. Did your perception of the movie itself change through this process? Did you fall out of love, in love with your work, or was it kind of the same work
No,
once you'd
it
done
was
it?
Kind of the same work, but maybe with the stake... of the success, you're obliged to do another success. You confront yourself to success. You're committed to success, which is not good, because you think about what the movie is going to do. And I was very lucky to do two times such big success. Foreign pictures, I mean.
Right.
Because this is the difference. I discovered the difference. More than the success or anything else, I discovered the difference between the situation, the privilege, and the disaster of being a French director. Mm-hmm. Which is, the privilege is that you're basically very free to do whatever you want. Mm-hmm. The pressure is not that big, or wasn't that big. Mm-hmm. And the disaster is that you don't understand that the rest of the world doesn't work like this, and especially in America. Mm-hmm. And I was asked, like every director who has a success in America, to go to Hollywood. Right. JJ goes to Hollywood. And that was a disaster, because I didn't behave the way I should have, probably. Mm-hmm. But in the meantime, it helped me to understand that I was interested in making films in a way which was mine, and not to compromise. And slowly I discovered that it was almost impossible for me to match the standard of how they do films here.
Match it in terms of dumbing it down, or match it in terms of the technology?
No, the technology. No. The technology is the easiest part. No, in terms of power, in terms of politics, in terms of how a film is divided, the power is divided into many different levels of, like, agents, lawyers, studios, executives, producers. Actors, the quest for actors. I played this game for years. I mean, I intend to write a book about that one day. I tried to set up a project about vampire, a comedy. And I'm still trying. It's 27 years. A project that I was asked to develop for Paramount in 1983. Right. I got a development deal, and because I was French, I thought as soon as you develop a movie, you are going to make it. Mm-hmm. That was the first mistake. The second mistake was, in America, everything is big. Mm-hmm. We are tiny old people in Europe. So we think our film too small. Mm-hmm. So the minute I was hired to write this, and they allowed me to write it, mm-hmm. which I didn't understand how much it was a privilege. Mm-hmm. Because I was so hot with Diva.
Right.
So I had the right to write it. Mm-hmm. But so I thought, I'm going to make the movie. And I was thinking Spielberg. I was thinking mm-hmm. John Landis. Mm-hmm. And when they asked me what kind of film I wanted to make, I said, it's like in between Blue Brothers and Bal des Vampires from... Roman Polanski, mm-hmm. and they start to freak out because Blue Brother was a big flop.
Right, though it made actually a lot of money. That's the
yes, of course, of course. But like... I always said it's going to make money,
yeah.
And they look at me like this poor French is really somewhere else. And the Bal des Vampires was a big success in Europe, but mm-hmm. made a flop here as well. Mm-hmm. And they told me. Here in Hollywood, we don't make vampire movie. Hmm. I said, you're going to make 10 of right. them within the years. Mm-hmm. So I've been right and wrong.
So was there a sense at that point that you needed to attach a big enough star to make your vampire movie, or make your vampires irrelevant? So you
That's why I mentioned Red, mm-hmm. because the restaurant...
Right.
Because this is where I met Cameron Diaz. Mm. She gave me a rendezvous over there. Mm-hmm. And she arrived in her black Mercedes. And she ate a whole plate of potatoes. And I said, how can you eat that mm-hmm. and get slim? She said, no, that's the way I am. So, and I offered her the film. I thought she would be great. I saw her. Much before, long before she was a star.
Bigger star, yeah.
I don't remember, it was an English film, mm-hmm. English director. Mm. She was starring in this. Uh-huh. We offered her a $10 million. It
wasn't enough.
It was enough. It's the biggest check I signed in my life. Mm-hmm. But let's be clear. This is the way you do. At least you promise. You make a promise to the star. Mm-hmm. You sign the check, but it's related to an American distribution.
Right.
So if we got you will get a $10 million yeah. fee. That was the fee she had at that time. Mm-hmm. But what you realize is that you're not the only one. To make mm-hmm. this kind of offer.
Right.
You know, she get probably every day, not yeah. every day or every week or every month, the yeah. same. So then it's going to to make a choice between two or five pictures because that's her price.
Right.
So
are you at that point seducing, is she loving your films that she's
Oh, she said Betty Blue, I love it. I love it. I mean, that's why she was she met me mm-hmm. just because of Betty Blue. That was that episode took place in 1998.
And was this as hard was your vampire movie as kind of pushing the envelope as your earlier films, or had you kind of Hollywood-fied it a little bit and made it more palatable or easily? I mean, was it a hard R movie? Was it a...
No. It was a comedy. It's pure comedy, slapstick, very funny, a comedy of characters. Mm-hmm. In two lines, it's the pitch is two young vampire mm-hmm. wants to buy a haunted castle to get out of the craziness of the world. Mm-hmm. It takes place in Paris.
Right.
And they cannot get the money because it's mm-hmm. very expensive and some cheek from Abu Dhabi want to buy mm-hmm. the place to bring it to the Emirates and to do to do into it a medieval pizzeria. It's wild, I tell you. And they have 10 days to get thousands of millions, several million dollars to auction this before the cheek.
Right.
So the girl, she decide to do a robbery on top of the hugest skyscraper of the city, which owned by the mafia, Italian mafia, subletting it to the Russian mafia. And there is a casino, and the money goes on top of the skyscraper. So they decide to do the robbery, and she thinks that she's going to use her magic power because she has just met a young boy who's another vampire, but he's older than her, and because she's too young, she cannot fly. She doesn't know anything.
Right.
So she thinks he does, and he doesn't. So the story is they have because they are. They are incompetent vampires, and as they and they want to find an old creep of the 13th century in order to teach them crash course how to fly, to turn into wolf, bats, etc. And they find one, but he hates kids. He thinks they are absolutely barbarian. They went directly from dawn to decadence without having known the golden age,
right.
And said, "I'm not going to teach you anything. You are not You are not capable to learn anything." And this will be the relation of this old vampire and this two young vampire trying to steal the money to buy a haunted castle.
So it's kind of a suburban comedy with vampires.
Yes. It's very. It's very. It talks about nowadays. It talks about the craziness of the days. And it's very tender. It's a love story. Mm-hmm. It's a magical story. It's romantic. It's fun. Seriously.
Yeah. So is this a film you can make in France? I mean, is this not a...
Too expensive. Too expensive. It was like 40, 50 million dollars. But I met all the... Brendan Fraser at that time. I'd say yes. But he wasn't known. The minute he became known, finished. I met Cameron Diaz, as I told you, Charlie Theron. I met everybody.
Right.
I went from a studio to another studio. It's you know, one of those stories that...
Was there anything good about the Hollywood experience for you?
It's funny. Really funny. Because I saw that, in fact... the people are as exposed as you are, in danger. In the musical chairs, you talk with somebody. The minute after, it's somebody else, and this somebody else has nothing to do than to bury what the other had made before. That's why it takes 10 years to set up a project. I discovered the power of agents and stars, and how difficult it is to get in touch with them if you're not into the socializing, etc., which I'm not good at.
So and it's completely different in France. I mean, you've certainly had your stars in France.
Yeah, it's about the same, but we live in a small village, so it's easy to meet people. But it's about the same, except the size, you know, the size. The size here is 100 times bigger.
Well, you've discovered or initiated the careers, or been early in the careers of a number of stars that were over there. I mean, does somebody like Depardieu just want to work and works a lot and that's, you know, what it is? Or is it as much of a dance as it is here for somebody like that who's...
I don't get...
Well, I mean, the bigger stars in France, you've worked with a lot of them, some of them pretty early in their careers. So, I mean, is it a similar kind of dance when you want to make a movie over there and you want to get together, you know, a cast like that?
Yes. But it's about the same because it's a question of momentum. You can get the people you think you will never get because this is a good timing. You know, for example, when I hired Yves Montand, who was a big star. He was in between a show. Mm-hmm. He was going to sing, and he had finished a film, and he was feeling that he was a little bit behind regarding young directors, so mm-hmm. he almost wanted to make this movie. He was ready to make it. Mm-hmm. Stars are the first benefiters of their privilege and, mm-hmm. and position, and the first to pay the highest price, because they are entirely handcuffed mm-hmm. to this golden cage they live in. Mm-hmm. Tom Cruise has to make another impossible mission.
Right.
But the impossible mission is to get out of the ghetto. That's mm-hmm. the impossible mission. He cannot do what he wants.
Right. It's a very high-priced ghetto, though.
They have to make money.
Yeah.
And they are meant to make money. The minute you don't make money, you're nobody. Mm. It's fun.
And this is this way as well in France? Except in a smaller scale? I mean,
on a smaller scale. And with... was the fact that we are not, I mean, the scale is an explanation, but it's not all, because at the Prorata it's the same, but mm-hmm. we're not obliged to make, like in Hollywood, if we talk about the studios movies, mm-hmm. you have to release a picture worldwide. You have to make as much money mm-hmm. foreign as much as in America, and even more. So the cost of releasing a movie is so high, mm-hmm. the stakes are so high that it's as difficult as to launch a satellite or mm-hmm. a shuttle. It's dangerous. So they try to minimize the right. risk, and by doing that they minimize the stakes and they minimize the chance to do something interesting.
So a guy like Jean Desjardins, I hope I'm pronouncing his mm-hmm. name correctly,
yeah, yeah.
who seems to want to find, he's, you know, did the film with Jean Caron, and mm-hmm. he seems to be looking for something more like a film that you might make.
Exactly.
Can
I
he
thought,
afford to do that?
Yeah. We thought about him. Mm-hmm. My old vampire is a little bit older.
Right.
Which was another difficulty, because he's more aged than Jean.
But he's the kind of guy.
Jean Reno had mm. said yes. You know, I was always on the edge of making it. Mm-hmm. Was very close to make it. Very very close. Canal Plus was into this movie. I had a producer here. And one way or another, you know, it's the catch 22.
Right.
We never got the four figures.
Right.
Yeah, the four numbers.
Right.
Or the series of numbers to, mm-hmm. to get the can flush. You know, always one card was missing.
Right.
It was pretty tough to live.
But can somebody like him break out and do a movie that's, you know, this movie actually seems like it fits his profile,
mm-hmm.
Could he do a movie more like Betty Blue or Diva?
I don't think so. He's ready for that.
You don't think he's ready as an actor? Necessarily?
No. Not as an actor, but to take this kind of risk.
Because it could hurt him, make him financially?
No, I think he has fun doing what he does. He has the first part. He's the leader, and it's entertainment. Mm-hmm. One day he will... One day or another, mm-hmm. he will be tempted to do that. They are always tempted to come out of their jail. You know, have you noticed that any actor who's a comedian, I mean, who plays in comedy,
right.
one day or another wants to be the bad guy and make people cry,
mm-hmm.
always. And sometimes it works. Most often it doesn't.
Mm-hmm.
And then the audience said, we want the guy we know.
Yeah.
We want the same color, the same atmosphere, the same mm-hmm. ambiance. and you cannot do that. So if you have not started from the very beginning by being like this, this kind of actor who can place everything, like I'm very bad with names, especially with the jet lag, Rain Man.
Hoffman or Cruise?
Dustin Hoffman.
Yeah.
Is this kind of guy. Yeah. That's why I place him on a higher position than a lot of others, because they can do whatever they want, because they have always done like that. But this is also the quality of their characters.
It was interesting because he's hit that place in his life where financially he's not he's not as valuable as he was the studios, and now he's taking smaller roles and doing things where 10 years ago he wouldn't have, there's so many movies he didn't do because he just, it wasn't.
But he was, I thought he was picky and very difficult in choosing.
Very difficult.
In his parts.
He was known for shutting down movies more than anybody else in town.
Yeah.
So when you do a documentary like Locked In Syndrome, is that a film you would have liked to have made as a feature, or is that...
I could have, but I was almost offered it. Mm-hmm. I said, I already made it. You know, Diving Bell and Butterfly, the film, would never have been what it is, and I know, and I don't know what it is, without the documentary I've made, because this is the only document existing on how was the real Jean-Dominique, and I know the actor saw it in Buckle.
Yeah,
you know, hundreds.
Well, you can see if you watch the documentary, you can see a lot of things that Julian ended up putting into the feature in there. I mean, it's really quite remarkable that way.
So I had made the film. So if I have had to do the film, the feature, I would have betrayed a relation I had with Jean-Dominique. And a relation which was one of the most singular relation I ever had with anybody. Because this man was living at the limits of human being condition. Can you imagine being paralyzed entirely? You cannot move a finger. You can just blink an eye. And your brain is absolutely intact. And more than this, you have 24 hours a day to fly within your head. So you can think, planified, you can imagine, you can listen, you can do flashbacks, etc., etc. So when I've been asked to do this, I said, what are you talking to me? What are you telling me? A man wrote a book without being paralyzed? How can you do that? They said, read the book. I read the book and I said, yes, immediately. And then I went there, but you're in front of somebody you can talk to, but he doesn't answer. Believe me, it's one of the strangest feeling you can feel, you can have. The man understand, listen, but cannot even do what you do. Nods or laugh. And so suddenly you discovered how much a human being is related to a lot of things, and a lot of things which help you to communicate, to understand each other by the way you look, by the way your intonation. If you speak quickly, slowly, if you nod, you don't nod, how you smile, etc. And I learned the letters. And I start to talk with him like that, which is learning a new language. and talking with somebody who has no time for bullshit. Mm. You know, he didn't say goodbye, hello, no. Mm-hmm. What do you want? So it has been one of the most interesting film I've made.
And you made it in a very cinematic way. You didn't just
but
do a straight documentary. It's kind of...
It's impossible. I cannot. I've made documentaries. I've never been able to make a documentary. I mean, I discovered how much it was important to be a filmmaker, mm-hmm. and having a grammar, having words, and all that brings the cinema, and how much it was helpful to do a documentary. Mm-hmm. But the thing is that you have to serve a purpose, which is to be fair and loyal to the people you're filming, mm-hmm. which is not the case in feature film. You mm-hmm. can betray everybody, especially, you have to. Mm-hmm. Not in documentaries. In documentaries, you have to serve a purpose, you have to serve an idea, you have to serve something which is more important than the way you are going to show it. Mm-hmm. It's a school of humility, I think. Mm. And in one way, the film on Jean-Dominique is mm-hmm. one of the best films I've made. And at the same time, it's one of the most, simple. I didn't mm-hmm. try to do complicated things.
Right.
I had a very simple camera. No traveling, nothing, but I did traveling, I did mm-hmm. crane, I did everything. But it was like, I was absolutely free. Mm-hmm. I was doing what I wanted. And it was my way to picture this and this man. Mm-hmm. And I discovered that this is the only way I can be. That's why I never made a film here, because there is always someone who says, no, you should put it here. No, it's not like this. And no. That's it.
And yet your DP from back in the day has managed to make a lot of movies in Hollywood over the years. Is it just because that's being a DP is a gig and not your soul, or is that...
Oh, if you talk about Philippe Rousselot, I think, mm-hmm. he's a talented man, and Diva was such a hit all over the world that, of course, he was part of this success. And he got the reward of success, and he was a smart guy, mm-hmm. and his English was very good. He was he's very literate. So, not surprised.
Yeah.
He had ambition. And the only failure was when he made a picture.
Hmm. Right.
But that's always, it's like actors.
Actors who want to do something else.
Yeah.
Well, speaking of actors who want to do something else, I can't let you go asking you about The Day the Clown Cried, uh-huh. which you actually worked on.
Yeah.
Very few people have actually seen the movie ever.
Mm-hmm.
Is that with good reason?
I've no idea. I think it's purely a question of deal, contract, and legal things between mm-hmm. the producer and Jerry Lewis. For me, it's I don't see the things that way. For me, it was the perfect match of something that was belonging to my childhood. I love Jerry Lewis. Mm-hmm. He made me laugh. So I owed him something. I know the discussion between this guy is not a good actor, this guy is this is that. I mean, mm-hmm. in America, he was not as well considered as in France. Mm-hmm. I don't care. I thank him for having made me laugh. Really, and he was such a character, and so the day I got a call, I was still an assistant director, And they asked me if I would be assistant director for the Paris shooting of the day the clown cried. I said yes, immediately. And it's 2 weeks of an extraordinary relation without words. I just wanted to be as good as possible for this man. And I was watching him intensely and how he was knowing everything. He knew the camera, he knew the angles, he knew the lens, he knew everything. And on top of that, he was doing a show on the set. But the show he was doing was not just to be the center of the attention of everybody, but it was his way to direct as well. And it was the matching of reality and cinema. That's why I keep a great memory of that. And cherries on the cake. The film never made it through.
Is there something great about that? I mean, is that the cherry on the cake? Is it a good thing in some way?
I don't say it's a good thing, but it's the drama. Yeah. It's what makes, you know, the impossible dream. It's never ending story. It gives to this movie, to this experience, something. You would never talk to me about that if the film had been released, because probably, and frankly, when you see the film of the life, the Italian director, it's the same story. It's rather strange.
Oh, Life is Beautiful. Interesting. So, is that pursuit to the end part of the excitement of still being out there and working on your projects and getting things going still?
I can see, because I've been here for 30 years regularly, and meeting people close from here. I was visiting Hubert Selby, who wrote The Demon, The Last Exit to Brooklyn, who died 2 years ago, and who was on Rosaline and the Lions filming, and I own the rights of Demon. And he was talking about the way America has changed, and I just wanted to hear from him a few things that I guessed they were in Demon, and be sure that I was properly reading his book, and the adaptation I wanted to make was good. And I asked him, what is it about, this book? Isn't it about greed? And he said, yes, it's about greed. And America is greed. And then he said, look at what they've done to Times Square. I hate them. So the business has changed a lot. More chance for independent pictures. Studios are just paying the price of their stiff policy. But in the meantime, when you own a section, a crossroad, and people have to get through, you always have the chance to pick up. So the system is regenerating itself. So we won't change that. And as I don't want to change myself, life is going to go on forever like this. No problem. It's a miracle. You have every day a newcomer, a new girl, a pretty face, a pretty nice looking boy who's ready to kill himself for being under the light. So the system lives from that and makes us from new, fresh blood. And every day you have a bunch of the same guys who are just kicked out. And this phrase, which is Hollywood in Sunset Boulevard when she comes back to the studio meeting Cecile Bédémile, and somebody recognize her and they move the sunlight on her. And suddenly she's like this, oh, yes. And Cecile Bédémile comes back and says in the loudspeaker, he said, put that light where it belongs. Put back this light to where it belongs. So it doesn't belong to you. Mm-hmm. Lights makes you the one. So to get this privilege, you have to accept some compromise or be smart. Adaptable, whatever, I don't know.
Or not.
Or not, because there are so many other ways to make films. You just have to adapt the frame and the scope of your productions. Mm-hmm. You can make a film with this now. Why not? Yeah. As far as you have to go back to the school of the old masters who's on top of the mountain, and he says, 2 days I have 100 pupils, it's as good. Tomorrow I have one, it's better. Mm.